Hi, I'm Rich Castillo. You're locked into the Unsigned Zone, and this is my industry. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I'm a manager. I manage N-Dubs. I've been a part of N-Dubs for the last 4.5 years, and I've been there throughout every single album they've put out and the last 10 singles that they've put out. I've done all the tours. I've done the book, we've done the TV show, we've done right across the board, right 360 of the whole industry of N-Dubs. Before that I did Jamelia, I've done shows for MTV, I've put a girl group together called Trinity Stone for Sony quite a few years ago. I now have a publishing company with Warner Chappell, and I consult A&R for All Around the World Records, which are the label that N-Dubs go through. I met N-Dubs through Colin Barlow and Jonathan Shallett. I was working with Jonathan Shallett at the time, and Colin Barlow, who used to run Polydor, who's a very sort of respected MD at labels now. I think he's just taken over RCA, but he was running Polydor at the time. We had another act that we were looking at getting signed, which weren't ready in hindsight, but we had the meeting anyway. And at the time, Dappy's dad was managing the band, and Dappy's dad passed away around that sort of time. And obviously, Jonathan Shallett, who I was working with at the time, had done a group called Big Brothers just before that, who were quite successful, but never really sold many albums, but there were some really big singles. From that, Colin Barlow asked us to go and meet the band. We met the band. Obviously, it was a sensitive time because Dappy's dad had just died, and he'd basically run the whole thing and put it together and driven the whole thing from the get-go, from when they were kids. At this age, they were like 18 at this point, and they'd been going since they were 11. So as much as they were new, they'd been going for quite a long time. We went to meet the band. I went to meet them, and obviously I sort of connected with them. I stalked them for about a month and a half. I went to every show. I just got to know Fazer very well. I was just that face that just kept turning up. And we just got on. I was such a big fan of what they do, because I'd seen them do shows before in the city and other stuff, and I just thought they had incredible energy. The only issue we had was the fact that no other groups at that time were selling records in that area, and as far as the sort of majors were concerned, all the kids that were into that music stole music and didn't pay for it. So they couldn't see a way of it making money, because there just wasn't. Luckily enough, they were blowing up on a channel called Channel AKA, which is called Channel U at the time, it's now called AKA. They were blowing up on there, and the label they were now with was involved in the channel and was helped funded part of it, and had a business relationship with the owner, Darren Platt. And Darren basically had mentioned it to Chris Nuttall, the owner of All Around the World. And obviously they'd seen all the text information that was going into the channel, because they run a texting system where if you like an act that you text in, and that act gets played the most, and N-Dubs were winning it over and over and over. And there was such a buzz in them in the sort of urban world, but not in the mainstream world, because the dots hadn't connected yet, because mainstream television and mainstream press and all that other stuff hadn't sort of acknowledged the urban world at that stage. So off the back of that, we got one single deal with All Around the World, on the basis that if it does well, they pick up the next record. It did. The first record we put out on them was a song called Ouch, which did well. And then we did Pop Can You Hear Me. Then the label actually took a massive risk and spent a shitload of money on TV advertising that year, and decided that we'd put the album out. So I spent about 3 months with Dappy and Fazer and Talita running around Camden, collecting old hard drives, some records that they've sort of half started but needed finishing. And we pulled the first record, Uncle B, together, and it midweek to number 4 ahead of Beyonce on their debut album, which sort of went against everything that we sort of was predicted. So yeah, and that was it. As soon as that happened, it just went nuts. Everyone's calling us, everyone wants to know about it. And then off the back of that, every urban act from here to bloody Scotland had a looking at a record label. My proudest moment so far was when we sold out the O2 Arena earlier this year. We'd gone from 7 months ago going for an idea and a concept of what the tour should be on the end of Love Live Life tour. And the process of going from being in a room with three of them and my production manager, my choreographer, myself, and flinging ideas out, like things that they wanted to do, to actually turning up at the O2 Arena and seeing 19,000 people screaming the band's name, knowing every word to every song, and seeing everything that we put on stage and everything we thought about in that meeting come to fruition was a real sort of jaw-dropping moment once we got there, because it was just like we had an idea and we followed it all the way through to the end of selling tickets and seeing people do a show. And it went so well that we got a DVD from the actual show, and it ended up being transmitted on Channel 4. Also, Talisa getting X Factor was amazing. It was a nod to say that she's accepted. When we first signed N-Dubs to a major label, no urban acts were selling albums. They just wasn't doing it. I do think they've opened the door. I think people like Tiny Temper, Chipmunk, Tinchy Strider, Rex 3-2, all these other artists that have come through have done really well, sort of thing. I've done so because of the, not totally because of, but I think ended up opening the door for them that helped make their deals a lot easier to get. But that takes nothing away from what they do, because they're incredible and they've sort of taken it on to another level. So the day-to-day of a manager's role is to be the in-between between the artist and the record label and the artist and the publisher. So day-to-day we do organise diaries, negotiate business deals for the artists, and try and enhance their career by accommodating them with key people that could sort of make them bigger than what they are. The way a manager gets paid is he normally takes 20% of the artist's net revenue. So whenever the artist gets paid, the manager will normally take 20% of that, and that's how it works. Some managers will ask for 25%, some managers will go as low as sort of 15%, but the general sort of number is 20%. That's the sort of industry standard. So if someone asks for more than that, then they need to be able to provide you with a damn good reason. Tips for aspiring managers are to be as organised as you possibly can, build up your contact list, make sure you have a good rapport with the key people in the industry, from radio to TV to publishers and to record labels. Go out to as many gigs as you can, meet as many people, and it's all about your contact list and who you know and whether you can articulate the artist's vision in a way that helps them. So tips that I give for unsigned artists is similar to this managers that want to get into the business. Is A, do your research. B, know what you are. If you're a rapper and you're all about rapping and whatever, don't try and sing. If you're a proper singer person, don't try and rap, and vice versa. So know what you are. Try and have a vision for how you can see yourself getting out there. So do your research on what producers and writers you think would accommodate what you do. If you've got like a really good hip hop record, I'd research who's the best person in that area in the UK that I can actually get a hold of, and try and send them emails and try and get in contact with them. I think the first step is to understand what you are as an artist. Second thing is, don't try and do everything. And that's what a manager's there for. So you need to go out and find a team of people that can sort of facilitate what you do day to day. If you're a really strong artist and you're all about your artistry, you don't really want to be organising emails and sorting out invoices and sorting out diary sort of stuff. You want to have somebody in place to be able to do that. So I'd try and find a team of people, a young bunch of people, even if it's a good friend who's sort of really sort of business savvy, who you know at the start, who can start the sort of wheels turning in it. I'd do that to start off with. The qualities that I look for in an artist are people that have that are different, that know what they are, that are willing to drive a campaign and have a strong vision. Because there's nothing worse than getting an artist and you go to a record label and they've got to create this image and everything else for you. I prefer for someone to already have their swag and their sort of style that they want to go in. So all I have to do is enhance that. As a manager, I think your job is to accommodate an artist and to try and provide things around them that help them be what they want to be, rather than give them a vision of what they should be. So what I try and do is I try and find people that are very clear in what they want, what they are. So we've got a kid called Young Ads and his brother Benjamin AD. When it comes to doing stuff, they're very clear. They're very clear on what they are and what they don't want to do. So it's very easy for me to sort of get stuff done, because I know immediately what they want and what they will and won't do. I know if it's something I'm not sure, when I can call them, they'll make it very clear to me that they don't want to do it, or this is what it should be. There's nothing worse than having a bunch of people that procrastinate and are not sure what they want to be and need sort of artistic, sort of a lot of artistic input. As much as we are a creative team and we do sort of help assist people's creations and visions, we accommodate more than that. We accommodate more than we sort of instigate. For us to do what we do with N-Dubs, The Legacy, with Encore, with Charlie, with writers like Ayak and Jerome and Focus and C Major, she's reminding me. We there's a team of us that do it, so it's not just myself. I have Nadia, who's over here, and I have another guy called Dean who works with me as well. And between the three of us, we all sort of cross over all the acts, and we make sure that everyone's serviced and make sure that everyone in the industry knows what's going on. And if there's any other opportunities going on, then we'll make sure we're trying to be first to it and to give make sure our acts all get a decent chance of being seen properly. Dappy told me a quote a while ago. It was like, I say a quote, but he always said, you should never give up on something that you can't go a day without thinking of. If that makes sense. So it's something in you that's burning you every single day, whether that's music or whether that's designing cars or whatnot. I'm a massive believer of perseverance and the longer game and not giving up on things. There are a lot of artists who have been told no that have followed through. Some of the biggest artists in the world, the Beatles, Take That. I don't know any of the, not really that many massive artists that are global leaders that didn't suffer massive rejection very early. I mean, there isn't really any that I can think of that didn't sort of have to really jump through a few hoops just to sort of be heard. Even Eminem, everyone knows the story of him, and I think, but by the same token, you have to be sensible as well, and you have to know if this is not your area of music, if music is not your thing, then you shouldn't be doing it. But if you have that burning desire to crack on and do it, then I think perseverance is everything and you can really sort of push through. And even myself, getting into the business was quite hard initially, but I was determined to do it, and I did enough research and looked into it properly enough and applied myself in a way where I reduced the odds of failing by a lot. Just by making sure I approach people in the right way and making sure I created opportunities for myself. I mean, even to this day, I don't believe I've ever had a promotion or anything that I haven't instigated myself, that I haven't suggested myself for. So I don't think you can wait around and wait for people to sort of give it to you. I think you should always push and knock the door down and be resilient in your approach.